Without truth, there can be no justice.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, have you reached a verdict?
We have, Your Honor.
Speak out! Ask those questions! Demand that truth!
Hi everyone, and welcome to episode 12 of Truth is Justice. There have been frequent suggestions that the investigation led by Detectives Carrizal and Doucet should have gone further. We've heard claims that for an investigation to have been considered thorough by some groups, the detectives should have taken certain steps, including requesting the cell tower records, taking into evidence and then performing forensic analysis on all of the knives at the Los Cucos restaurant, performing background checks and then, if necessary, performing investigations into all of the staff that worked at Los Cucos, sourcing and then reviewing the home security camera footage from all of the streets surrounding the Melgars' home, not just the neighbours, and obtaining data on and then performing background checks on all of the purchases of a specific white blouse sold at Costco stores. Perhaps in an ideal world, at least an ideal world according to some views, law enforcement generally would be assigned infinite resources and have access to unlimited hours to conduct investigations. From the smallest town to the largest city, this type of resource allocation would allow every crime to be investigated so extensively that the case would likely need multiple trucks to transport individual case materials. Of course, it would take not just infinite resources, but it would also take a very relaxed approach to an individual's privacy and an individual's right to go about their life without interference. And of course, it would take the courts to have a very relaxed view to what subpoenas could be submitted, what warrants could be issued, and what was considered generally relevant to a given case. But assuming that is all covered off, what would it actually achieve? Would it actually be something that would ensure that the right person is convicted of a crime? I don't think so. In fact, my suspicion is that it would provide such massive amounts of evidence that the defence, any defence, could be quite compelling, even for those that were wholly guilty of a crime. And I'll explain. If any of you have ever purchased an item from a hardware store, say a hammer or a crowbar or a large screwdriver, think about whether you have ever, when choosing that hammer or crowbar or screwdriver, picked up and looked at a particular make and then put it back on the shelf. So for example, a given hardware store might have 10 different brands of hammers. So in deciding which is best, you pick up three that are closest to what you are looking for before making your final choice and purchasing one hammer, putting the other ones back on the shelf. Obviously now, your fingerprints and your DNA is on the two hammers that you return to the shelf. What happens to those two hammers? So who purchases them? What do they use them for? You obviously have no idea what the future holds for those hammers, and nor would you really care. But let's look at how an investigation with unlimited resources could bring about a huge headache for you and potentially let a guilty person remain free. Consider a hypothetical situation where a person is murdered in their own home. There are no witnesses, and the murderer was careful, and lucky, to not leave any of their DNA or their fingerprints at the scene. Investigators come in and they assess the scene. Person has been shot dead in their garage beside a home workshop in what appears to be a robbery gone wrong. The victim was shot at close range with a small caliber gun after being tied up, and the house has indications of being ransacked. Close to the victim's body is a workbench, and sitting on top of the workbench is a hammer. Now, with infinite resources, the investigators are able to take every single item in the house into evidence and perform a complete and thorough forensic analysis on each item. The hammer comes back from its forensic analysis, and it shows unknown DNA and clear liftable fingerprints. The fingerprints don't show up any immediate matches, but the DNA is compared with online DNA databases and it shows up a potential match, or at least a match with a group of people from an extended family, one or two of whom may have submitted their DNA for genealogy purposes. After performing background checks on each of these people, they are all called upon to provide DNA samples and fingerprints. Of course, your fingerprints match the hammer, and your DNA is found on the hammer, but the truly shocking news comes when your DNA is also found on a pair of gloves found at the scene of the murder. Adding to the suspicions surrounding you, the murder victim lives only a short drive from your home. Your family members, current and previous employers, are all interviewed, and of course you are brought in for an extensive interview with the lead detectives. You don't initially remember, but the day you went into the hardware store was hot and you were sweating. You remember wiping your forehead prior to making a selection of the hammers. But little did you know that a short time later, a person would come in and purchase one of the hammers that you put back. They used the hammer with a pair of gloves and transferred your DNA, which was on the hammer from the sweat, onto the gloves. Now, would this be enough to convict you? Perhaps not. But would it be enough to help a defendant if the actual murderer was ever found? Yes, maybe. In fact, consider all of the items in the home being submitted for similar forensic testing and DNA and fingerprint analysis. The DNA and fingerprints obtained would be significant, and with a large enough pool, would surely end up leading to someone with a criminal history that is in some way relevant to the crime. So an assault charge or a domestic violence incident, for example. The defendant now has, with a good defence attorney, a pretty solid defence and a reasonable expectation for a jury to have reasonable doubt, even if they are 100% guilty of the crime. I seem far-fetched? Well, not really. All it takes is infinite resources and work hours, and instead of getting closer to justice, you have caused significant distress and likely professional career damage to many people entirely unrelated to the crime, and you've provided the actual person who committed the crime with a reasonably solid defence. Now, just one more brief example that I think could have even more disastrous outcomes. For those that have ever purchased a bottle of bleach from a supermarket, think about whether you have ever grabbed a bottle and put it back on the shelf whilst deciding on another. Imagine what the future of that bottle of bleach is. Most likely nothing interesting, but imagine if that bottle of bleach was found at a crime scene. A crime scene completely devoid of DNA or fingerprints, except for yours, which was found on the bottle of bleach right next to an obviously cleaned up crime scene. Again, it makes a pretty compelling story from a defence perspective. The person who committed the crime wanted to clean up and so took off their gloves whilst doing so, forgetting that it would leave their DNA and fingerprints on the actual bottle of bleach. You're matched in a similar way to that in the previous example, and to say it would represent a headache for you is obviously a massive understatement. Now recall the two other items I mentioned earlier in the hardware store example, a crowbar and a screwdriver. Well, it isn't difficult to see the problems that could be caused by those both being used, or suspected of being used, in a crime. And you can keep going and going with the examples. Visiting a hairdresser or a barber in the next few days? Well, imagine someone sitting on the same chair and a strand of your hair lodging in that person's clothing. And then what if that person is the victim of a crime and your hair is analysed? Obviously not a good situation. Now, the point I am not making with these examples is that analysis, DNA and fingerprints etc., is not valuable. Absolutely it is, of course, and I'm not someone who is precious when it comes to my rights to privacy in that respect. The point I am making with these examples is that crime scene investigation and the investigation of crimes generally is not entirely about how extensive the investigation is with respect to gathering and analysing irrelevant evidence. A more extensive investigation, meaning that more evidence is gathered, more individuals are interviewed, more suspects are identified, does not necessarily mean that the actual person who committed the crime is going to be convicted. What it almost certainly does guarantee, however, is that the defendant will have a far stronger case to be able to point to reasonable doubt. And what these examples also hopefully do is show you how relatively easy it is to obtain fodder for a wrongful conviction claim and any associated podcasts. Imagine in the example above if the glove and hammer were tested and showed unknown DNA and fingerprints, but the unlimited resources weren't available and the connections weren't drawn with you and the actual murderer was rightly convicted. Imagine starting a wrongful conviction podcast and focusing on that hammer and on the unknown DNA and fingerprints. He could assert that the investigation was below par, and that the DNA on the glove and the fingerprints and the DNA on the hammer belonged to the actual murderer. And it would make for a reasonably compelling argument. But in the end, that is about where it would finish, because the various elements of the justice system have been built and refined over many, many years, meaning that largely, these red herrings are identified as such, and the right person, in many, many instances, is convicted. The generally accepted red herrings are then left for the wrongful conviction discussions, which we are now somewhat accustomed to. And when we think and talk about the thoroughness of investigations, it isn't just items like that. If you think about it, people could ask whether the lead detectives contacted Google to check whether a Google Maps vehicle was taking pictures on the Melgars' home that morning. They could also ask whether the military was contacted to see if a satellite was passing overhead at or around the time of the murder and possibly had images of the Melgars' home. You could also ask whether all cars driving on the 249 and surrounding roads that evening were identified by conducting roadblocks on subsequent nights and obtaining and reviewing dashcam footage from the night in question. You could ask whether every inmate held in prisons across the United States was shown drawings of the person Sandra apparently recalled seeing. You could ask whether people flying in and out of Houston Airport and all of those departing from international points of departure across the country were investigated to determine if they had any connection to the crime. But the answer to all of those is probably no. And is that wrong, or does that suggest a substandard investigation? Of course not. It doesn't at all. Claims made that the investigation into the murder of Mr. Jaime Melgar was substandard and didn't go far enough in gathering data often miss or deliberately ignore one vital element of the investigation – experience. See, the investigation into the crime isn't just the gathering of evidence samples and data and the searching of databases and interviewing of potential suspects. It's about the experience that the lead detectives and every single person involved in the investigation brings to the table. From the very first responders to the lead prosecutor speaking the final words of a closing statement at trial. It's the knowledge that the collective group brings to the case that helps determine where to direct resources, finite resources, and where the majority of the energy of the group should be focused. It's that experience that tells investigators whether they should seek to take every single item in the home and conduct exhaustive forensic testing on each of them. It's that experience that tells investigators whether they should seek to turn a business upside down in taking into evidence every sharp utensil in the business. It's that experience that in the end is what makes the difference. We will show you in this episode and in coming episodes how crucial experience is, and equally how convenient it can be for others to dismiss experience in certain circumstances and then wholly embrace it in others. We are Truth is Justice, and we are setting the record straight. This week, we move from the master bathroom closet to the master bedroom, and there's a lot happening in this room, and we'll highlight and discuss each significant point. But before we start, I wanted to briefly talk about staged crime scenes. Now, I'm no expert on this, and I don't pretend to be one on the internet or on podcasts. But who do I consider to be an expert on staged crime scenes? Well, someone who has seen what an actual crime scene of the type that's been staged would look like. So to put this in perhaps more relatable form, consider someone who has lied to you about a particular experience, whether it's a sporting achievement or a particular experience they claim to have had or claiming to have visited a particular place. Now, how can you tell whether the person is lying? Well, usually a good indicator is you know the particular achievement or experience or place, so you can determine whether anything is off with their description. You can ask specific questions about certain elements, and the story begins to fall away. You knew. You were in some way an expert because you knew how what they were trying to lie about was actually meant to be when they didn't. It reminds me of a movie. I can't think of the name right now, but a person's bragging about climbing Mount Everest. And when he's asked whether he stayed at base camp at 32,000 feet or 34,000 feet or something similar, he confidently says 34,000 feet. Now, with a total height of 29,000 feet, obviously the claim was wrong. And then we learn that the character was simply lying to try and boost his image. It was discovered because they were trying to fool someone who knew, an expert of sorts, because they knew what Everest was about, and they knew the details of it. And the investigators, Detectives Carrizal and Doucet, and many of the various law enforcement officers present at the Melgar home, and who conducted analysis on the scene afterwards, were also experts. They know what to look for. And they've done more than watch TV shows and skim through textbooks. They've actually witnessed different crime scenes. Homicides, burglaries, home invasions. They've seen how they normally are. So one that is different stands out to them. Now, of course there are outliers, situations that are so drastically different that they don't fit into a normal mould, but they are exceedingly rare, and then they usually have their own attributes and their own identifiers, which mark them as such. So for example, an execution-style killing will have its own attributes and will stand out for detectives for particular reasons. A domestic homicide will also have its own attributes and will stand out to detectives for particular reasons. A burglary gone wrong or a home invasion, they will stand out for detectives for particular reasons. Importantly, a domestic homicide staged to look like a burglary gone wrong will also have particular characteristics. It will miss certain elements that a burglary might ordinarily have, or it will have additions or elements that a burglary wouldn't ordinarily have. Dr. Hahn Gross is one of the most influential authors when it comes to forensic criminology, and he's considered by many to be the founding father of criminal profiling. Despite his book being nearly a century old, he is one of the few authors that has attempted to tackle stage crime scenes and the signs that investigators need to be aware of. Dr. Gross talks about defects of the situation and what he terms as grand blunders, being mistakes that have been made that even the most experienced and crafty criminal rarely fails to commit. It's worth noting that Dr. Gross highlights how crime scene staging is something performed mainly by those in the middle to upper class. It's not something that Dr. Gross highlights as being observed as occurring with the poor. The FBI's Crime Classification Manual also provides us with some very useful information with which to view and better understand the crime scene, and we'll discuss that in a minute. Ms. Claire Ferguson, a PhD student at Bond University, wrote an excellent thesis on staged crime scenes titled The Defects of the Situation, A Typology of Staged Crime Scenes. If you have an opportunity, I'd suggest Googling it and downloading it. It's a very interesting read, given that she has reviewed the most relevant sections of an extensive list of authored works on the staging of crime scenes. She notes, with academic support, that the inconsistencies which are noticed by investigators are due to the fact that the offender staged elements of the crime scene to appear as he or she thinks they should appear, not as they necessarily would appear if the scenario was legitimate. So, for example, if staging a domestic homicide to look like a stranger burglary and then a homicide, the offender may have no insight into how a real stranger burglary and then a homicide actually presents, having never committed, investigated, or been the victim of one. They'll be forced then to stage the scene to resemble how they think a burglary would look, all while under the stress of having just committed a homicide. And because of this stress and possible panic, the pieces may not fit together in any logical way. And think about how often, during the consideration of this case, that phrase, that it's so confusing, has been spoken. Elements that seemingly don't fit, and things that should be reasonably straightforward, are complex and difficult to understand. An explanation, according to the literature, is that the scene has been staged by someone without experience in how an actual burglary would look. They go off mental images they have of how a crime scene should look, and that, combined with the stress of the situation, can make for a confusing scene. And that's what I suggest is actually what we see with the Melgar's home. Several queries are listed as being needed to be made of the crime scene. It's noted that the staged crime scene will often contain a number of red flags in the form of crime scene inconsistencies. It's noted that the crime scene investigator should consider all elements first individually and then importantly as part of the whole picture. Now, I'll list out these red flags, but as I do, think about how that relates to the situation at the Melgars' home. The first red flag. Were there inappropriate items taken from the crime scene if burglary appears to be the motive? And the second red flag, did the point of entry actually make sense? And the third red flag, did the perpetration of this crime pose a high risk to the alleged offender? And the fourth, do the injuries actually fit the crime? And the fifth, when an offender stages a domestic homicide, they frequently plan and manoeuvre for a third-party discovery of the victim. Offenders will often manipulate the victim's discovery by a neighbour or a family member. And sixth, indications of remorse by covering the victim in some way. In a study, Hazelwood and Napier in 2004 canvassed 20 consultants who have testified as experts or worked cases involving staged crime scenes. They asked the 20 consultants what types of staging were typically found. Behind the non-fatal allegations of sexual assault, the most common staging relates to staging domestic homicides as burglary-related or robbery-related homicides. Mr. Dan Vogel, a FBI special agent with 25 years of service, said it best when he said, and to quote, "Crime scene staging may be seen in violent crimes in which the perpetrator is closely associated with the victim and needs to direct attention to other suspects. The staging is usually obvious to a trained investigator who knows that the crime scene does not make sense and has been altered. It's important to note that an investigator observing a complex crime scene is no different from the investigator observing or interacting with a possibly deceptive suspect. They have things that they look for and signs that something is out of place. These are not couch experts or people who have watched a few TV shows. They're actual experts who have seen or analysed these types of scenes hundreds of times before." Now, in her paper, Ms. Ferguson highlights a range of different elements of the crime scene, and one of these is ransacking. It's defined as going hurriedly through a scene in an attempt to look for or steal things, making the scene look disordered and for things to be obviously out of place. It's noted that in the stage cases, ransacking may be used to imply that things were stolen when in fact they were not, or more simply, to give the impression that someone was looking for valuables within the scene and was disrupted in the process. And take particular note of that someone was looking for valuables and was potentially disrupted in the process. Now, if that sounds familiar, it's because it's a line fed out regularly by Bob and others. It's noted by Ms. Ferguson that the ransacking, at least the staged ransacking, is a common element in crime scene staging from her reviews of large volumes of case material. Another area considered is the cleanup of the scene. Ms. Ferguson notes that any case involving staging something that did not happen may also involve hiding, concealing, or cleaning up what did happen. And this may come in the form of destroying or interfering with clothing or other materials used during the offence, or physically cleaning up the scene in order to make it appear as though something else happened there. In some cases, instead of an absence of evidence which indicated cleanup, there may have been a presence of evidence, such as the smell of cleaning products or bloody clothing being present. And another area considered by Ms. Ferguson is the extent of self-injury of the offender. In an effort to legitimise the scenario which the offender seeks to portray, it's hypothesised that they may self-injure. And several anecdotal cases have involved offenders hitting themselves somewhat superficially on the head, and then claiming long periods of unconsciousness when the crime supposedly was taking place. Now, this is one of the more sophisticated staging behaviours, as Ms. Ferguson puts it, and clearly necessitates a real commitment to the effort on the part of the defender. Now, these words are directly from Ms. Ferguson's research, and notice the similarities to exactly what we see in this case. So while Sandra, if she staged the crime scene, may be of the opinion that her staging methods were somewhat unique and not distinguishable at all from the real thing, it would appear that she fits in exactly with the behaviour of others who have staged crime scenes under the same circumstances. Of the 141 staged homicides analysed by Ms. Ferguson from Australia, the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom, Miss Ferguson produces some very interesting results, and we'll consider some of those results here. So, in terms of the number of offenders involved in the staging, over 60% of the time it was one person who committed the crime. The next most frequent was two offenders at 17%. In terms of victims, over 80% of the time it was the one victim. The relationship between the victim and the offender was a known one in over 90% of the cases. It was the spouse, either recognised legally or in a domestic partnership or in a domestic relationship, in over 65% of the cases. Of the 141 cases of staging, guess which was by far the most common to reflect in staging? A home burglary or a home invasion? Over 43% of the cases were staged to look like a burglary or a home invasion. Of that 43% that was staged to look like a burglary or a home invasion, 50% were perpetrated by one offender, and over 70% had only one victim. Again, of those domestic homicides staged to look like burglaries, a staggering 77% involved a cohabitation relationship, for example, a spouse. Now, the most common place for victims to be discovered in this circumstance was in their bedroom. A staggering 40% of the time they were found in their own bedroom. Now, very interestingly, with respect to motive, in over 60% of the cases, the motive was found to be unclear. And we'll get into this in more detail in coming weeks, but the paper goes into detail with respect to the term overkill. And whilst it's been claimed by Bob and others that Jim's murder didn't involve overkill, consider how many attacking wounds and injuries Jim had. By that I mean indications that Jim was actually fighting back rather than just defending himself. The answer is very few. In fact, Jim's knuckles bore no signs of injury at all, or bruising, and under his nails were no signs of attempting to scratch his attacker. In terms of valuables being missing, so the staging of items being stolen, and remember this is only for the cases made to look like burglaries, interestingly, only 50% of the time items were actually removed from the home or disposed of, for example by flushing down the toilet. The point of entry and exit was not staged in 54% of the cases. In terms of injuries to the offender, so the person actually staging the crime scene, over 80% did not have any significant injuries. It's staggering, really. We've heard a lot about how Sandra was relatively unharmed. Well, from the evidence, that isn't at all unusual, especially in a domestic homicide situation. So as we progress over the next couple of weeks, try and keep each of these points in mind. One or two things that match may be a coincidence. When all of them match, well, I think that creates a very interesting picture. A picture that is entirely unhelpful to Sandra, but a picture that explains exactly why the investigation progressed in the way that it did. So moving now into the master bedroom. And Bob begins with a description of the nightstand in the southwest corner of the room. And Bob notes that all of the drawers of the nightstand are open, and the top drawer has a plastic grocery bag hanging out of it. And Bob notes that we also see a stack of workout DVDs in the drawer. And that may very well be true, but notice the difference here between what took place in the southeast corner bedroom and what is taking place here. You'll recall that in the southeast corner bedroom, that the drawer furthest from the door contained DVDs and Xbox games. The stack on the left, we could only see the top case, which was an Xbox game. How did Bob describe that drawer? We described it as containing one Xbox game. There was no suggestion of a stack of Xbox games, no, just the one, when at least four games were present. Now, of course it was done in that way because it fits the argument. If it was a stack of Xbox games and you're claiming that an intruder stole the Xbox and would steal games, well, they would take a stack of the games. So it's better to say that a small number of Xbox games were present. But in the master bedroom, where the argument now is that the TV was used to play workout DVDs, well, now we have a stack of workout DVDs, despite being only able to see a couple. See how the interpretation changes as is necessary. Bob then describes how on the floor in front of the nightstand is a clutch-type pouch, a case that may be for sunglasses and a Windsor Pilates workout DVD. Bob notes that Mr. Carpenter failed to mention the DVD, as well as the DVDs in the top drawer. Now that's true, but Mr. Carpenter took many photos. It clearly wasn't the intention to mislead. The photos were part of the record, and they demonstrate exactly what the scene was showing. Bob then highlights the makeshift antenna and the coax cable leading from the antenna in the direction of the nightstand. There have been various takes on the antenna from Bob and his group, and one suggestion was that the wire coat hanger hanging above the nightstand was used to support the antenna in place, and that in their rush, the intruders disconnected the antenna and carefully placed it up against the window in the position in which it was found. A brief side note here. I recall a discussion of this type quite vividly on the page associated with Bob's show. At least two listeners noted how they did exactly that. They used a wire coat hanger to support an antenna, with one even providing photographic evidence. Interestingly, in that example, the antenna was pointed down towards the ground, as would be the case when you're trying to support the antenna in that way. I remember asking the person why they thought they received a better signal pointing the antenna at the ground as opposed to sitting it facing up on the top of the TV or beside the TV, and they didn't know. And my suspicion, and I may be wrong, is that some people are very keen to substantiate Bob's claims with created evidence of their own, doing that to support Bob. Again, I may be wrong, but an interesting question to ask is how many people here angle their television antennas, if you still have them, pointed directly down towards the ground. Bob then notes that Mr. Carpenter didn't take a photo of what was behind the nightstand, but Bob highlights the end of the S video cable protruding from the side of it. And we've spoken about the S video cable before, and it's interesting, and I'll explain why in a minute. Bob notes there was a 32-inch TV and a DVD player on that nightstand, and he notes that Liz provided Detective Carrizal with the receipts. Note here that Bob is somewhat non-committal about what receipts were actually provided, but there is at least the inference that a receipt was provided for the TV and the DVD player, plural receipts, especially given that the line earlier, Bob noted how Jim kept receipts and manuals for just about everything he ever owned. Of course, we know now that that isn't how it panned out. Liz didn't provide a receipt for the TV to Detective Carrizal. A receipt was obtained for the Sylvania 32-inch TV DVD from a store over 5 hours away, and it was emailed to Detective Carrizal by Sandra's attorney. Now, onto the S video cable. So it's suggested that a TV, and importantly for the purposes of keeping the burglary narrative alive, not a 32-inch TV now, and not the Sylvania TV with internal DVD player. It's claimed that it was stolen from the dresser along with the DVD player. Now let's consider how that would happen in practice, especially because it's been suggested that it was done in a hurry, as in, the supposed intruders killed Jim, restrained Sandra, and then rushed out of there, tucking the TV under their arm, as Bob describes it. First, it would have required the TV and the DVD player to be unplugged from their respective sockets. Now, either there was a socket behind the dresser, or the nearest one was more than several feet away towards the back of the treadmill. So would the power cord from the TV or DVD player actually reach there? Most likely not. Most TV and DVD power cables aren't that long, and there isn't any extension cord present. So then we can consider if the socket was actually behind the cabinet. Have you ever tried to remove a plug from a socket from directly above by pulling on the cable? It isn't easy. In fact, it's extremely difficult. You're in a situation where you're panicked and you're wanting to leave as quickly as possible, yet you're then trying to remove two power sockets from the wall from directly above. I'm not sure it could be done, but if you were going to do it, I think you would simply move the dresser. But let's assume that they actually did, that they were able to get those power cords out. So the TV and DVD player power cords both removed from the wall behind the dresser somehow, and then in a rush, why remove the S video cable and then drop it behind the dresser? Surely you would grab both and not bother with removing cables interconnecting the two devices. Or if you did, surely you wouldn't stand next to the dresser and do it there, wasting precious time at a point where it suggested you would be panicked and wanting to quickly leave the house. And Bob then highlights the picture frame. He describes the size of the frame and notes how it's upside down next to the nightstand. There is more to that story though, and predictably, because it is not mentioned by Bob, more to the story from a perspective that is not supportive of Sandra's innocence. There are two picture frames. There's one on the nightstand, and then there's one on the floor, the one that Bob describes. The one on the floor is face down, so we can't see what's in it. But the one on the nightstand is empty. Now, in the rush to grab the TV and DVD player, it seems quite remarkable that the picture frame remains standing, and perhaps was just moved slightly to the side. Now, you could even ask the question, why a picture frame without a picture in it would be on display on the nightstand at all. And my suspicion, that the picture frames, along with the other items on the ground, were actually in the drawer and they were removed. So ask yourself, would an intruder then stand the picture frame up on top of the dresser? Or could someone drop the picture frame and some other items in front of the drawer to resemble what they believe a ransacked room might appear as? And then Bob gives a description of the glass on the treadmill, noting that it is the exact same type of glass that is sitting on the edge of the jacuzzi, except that it has a brown liquid and three lime wedges inside. The existence of this element is then extended to support the case that Sandra would not have staged the scene, that the presence of the drink was simply too supportive of her story to support being staged. Now, I disagree with that conclusion, on the basis of, when you think about it, what do we really have? We have a drink that Jim likely had. We have no idea whether it was placed in the treadmill by Jim or someone else, and we have no idea of where it was at the time that Jim was killed. We know Jim was drinking, per his autopsy results, but that's the extent of it. Bob then talks about the drawer unit. He notes how the left side of the sock drawer is empty, right above the six socks on the floor. And he notes how the top middle drawer is also open and doesn't contain clothes, but left inside is some cosmetic bottles and some jewelry boxes. The front middle section of that drawer is empty, with Bob noting that something was clearly removed from that space. Now keep in mind the ransacking item that we spoke about earlier. And what do we see in the sock drawer? We see some socks pulled out and dropped on the floor, and we see the other socks pushed over to the side. Now is that an indicator of a burglar looking for something? Or is it an indicator of someone tossing a few socks on the ground to perhaps resemble a ransacking? And what do we see in the top middle drawer? Now, I agree with Bob that clearly items such as jewelry boxes have been removed, and they've probably been placed a few feet away on the bed. So why would that be done? Think how a burglar may do it, especially if trying to move quickly. Would they move the boxes to the bed to then sort through them? Probably not. And we also have the lid to the ornate box sitting on the bed. Again, think about the value in doing that from the perspective of the intruder. Wouldn't a quicker way to obtain the contents be to simply empty out the contents of the ornate box into a pillow sham or into a bag? Bob notes that lastly, Mr. Carpenter mentions a pair of blue underwear on the floor near the doors to the bathroom. And Bob notes Mr. Carpenter didn't mention that these are very obviously women's underwear and they're also very obviously soiled. And the underwear represents a very interesting element of this case. And for those convinced of Sandra's innocence, the soiled underwear is conclusive evidence. They say, how could a woman deal with the prospect of being found with soiled underwear? They say that a woman simply wouldn't go that far, even after committing a murder. My personal view is that your soiled underwear being found is one thing that perhaps wouldn't make it onto a list of things that are off limits for most people in the situation where they have just committed a murder. But let's consider the soiled underwear. Firstly, when was it soiled? And we know the underwear is found near where the bedroom door meets the bathroom. It's in a very obvious spot. It's not hidden away or attempted to be put in a hidden area. No, it was placed in a position that would make it very obvious for anyone entering the room. There was no attempt to avoid embarrassment or for Maria, who assisted Sandra, to protect Sandra's modesty. It was left out in plain sight. And secondly, we know Sandra had diarrhea, at least that is what the report from Deputy Martinez, who was one of the first responders to arrive on the scene that night, testified to and documented in her report. So the question is asked, when did Sandra soil the underwear? Did she need to use the bathroom shortly after being discovered by Herman and Maria? Would she have simply removed the soiled underwear, not cleaned herself in any way, and then put on new underwear and jeans? No, she likely used the restroom in the master bathroom. Now, this next part is just pure speculation, of course, but what if the soiled underwear was completed at that point, in the privacy of the bathroom, and Sandra left the bathroom with her soiled underwear in her hand and walked into the master bedroom to deposit it where it was found? Now, the story surrounding the underwear does not stop there. Eliza's claimed that Sandra was refused access to the bathroom that evening by police, and that as a result, she was forced to soil a second pair of underwear. This is a claim which is in direct conflict with Deputy Martinez's report, and something that was not raised by Sandra's defence during trial. In fact, Deputy Martinez, during the trial, testifies to Sandra using the bathroom, not once, not twice, but three times from the time of arrival of law enforcement at the home. So why the discrepancy? Well, I think it's twofold. It cements a further conspiracy against Sandra by the family with respect to the investigation and the claim that reports, including that made by Deputy Martinez, were false. And secondly, it paints Sandra entirely as the victim, the person who was forced to soil their own underwear because of her treatment by law enforcement upon their arrival at the home. So, my take on the underwear and the claim that Sandra was prevented from using the bathroom. Firstly, we don't see the presence of a second soiled pair of underwear anywhere in the crime scene photos. Secondly, what does Deputy Martinez have to gain by lying not once or twice, but three times about Sandra using the bathroom? Arguably, Deputy Martinez could be conscious of the fact that she let Sandra use the bathroom the first time without accompanying her and the second time allowing her to begin washing her hands. And thirdly, why would Sandra's defence never raise such a seemingly obvious method to support the poor treatment of Sandra by law enforcement generally, especially when they comfortably raise so many other points? Like many things, the TV included, I think the story regarding the soiled underwear has developed out of thin air, and it's become an element that is clung to in support of Sandra's defence. Bob then describes the whole setup of the bed as odd, and I agree, but not for the reasons that Bob does. Now, it's noted that on the southeast corner of the bed, the blanket and sheets are pulled back from the corner. This is where there is a suggestion introduced that someone might have been looking under the mattress. Now, if they did that, they were very careful to not do so too hurriedly and to not allow the mattress to fall back too quickly, because the nightstand candle right beside it is still lit. Now, imagine lifting a mattress up and then dropping it right next to a lit candle. What would usually happen? Now, I agree with Bob that the crime scene with respect to the bed is odd. In fact, in my view, this is where the staging becomes truly obvious, and that is a reason for it appearing to be odd. I've spoken previously about the open wallets and purses on the bed. My take on that, I can't name the movie or TV show specifically, but my memory of depicted burglaries is intruders searching through wallets and purses and pulling each of the contents out and throwing them down. But thinking about it, what does that actually achieve? As in, why would an intruder take the time to search through a wallet rather than simply taking it with them or taking the cash and throwing the wallet? It's a dramatic element, and an element that very obviously screams burglary, but perhaps too obviously, perhaps exactly as someone would imagine a burglary would progress. Bob notes that the open closet door is blocking Jim's nightstand, and perhaps this is stated as a way of saying that the intruders didn't have the opportunity to gain access to the nightstand to steal items. And there are a few problems with that. Firstly, the closet door isn't blocking the nightstand. It's open, and it's in front of the nightstand, but there is clear room beside it to gain access to the nightstand. In fact, to lift up and search under the mattress, as Bob has described, you would need to be standing right next to the nightstand, past the closet door anyway. And secondly, the drawers to the nightstand are partially open, similar to what we have seen in various rooms of the house. This is another indication that perhaps the elements of the rooms that have been suggested represent evidence of a burglary, for example the open drawers and cabinet doors, were just a normal aspect of the Melgars' home. And Bob finishes the episode by saying that he has brought to light several areas of the crime scene that are clear indicators of a burglary. And next week, we'll begin with a thorough recap at what these clear indicators actually are. You'll see that far from being clear indicators, we actually have no evidence to suggest that intruders were present in the Melgar home. Next week, we move to the master bedroom closet and the areas immediately outside the master bedroom closet, including the dining chair and bath stool. We take a close look at how Bob and some of those people that support him directly attack an expert witness, Ms. Rossi. Once again, as we have so often seen during the season, this is done entirely without basis, and in a completely hypocritical way. We show how experience, in this case, a highly trained expert in her field, plays such a crucial role in understanding the crime scene and what actually took place. We look forward to you joining us next week, as we continue to set the record straight. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.